So we in nuclear medicine and in radiology in general, we deal with medical imaging. We provide physicians more than a crystal ball. We help them see the sites of disease and in various clinical applications. We know that we have different types of imaging that we can use, and we know the advantages of each of them, but each of them have also limitations and challenges, and therefore the fact that we can use today hybrid imaging, that we can combine structure and function, is very important. Actually, in nuclear medicine, when we moved from planar imaging to SPECT, we improved contrast and resolution, lesion detectability and sensitivity. When we added the CT, it was adding specificity. We are able to have a precise lesion localization, better image interpretation, which allowed us to have a higher diagnostic confidence, make a more accurate diagnosis, and improve clinical decision making. This was the first SPECT CT study that we did almost 20 years ago in a patient with thyroid cancer. We know that iodine-131 is a good tracer, or at least we thought it was a very good and very specific tracer for thyroid cancer only. But the more specific a radio tracer is, the less landmarks, geographical landmarks, did we have. So it was always very difficult to know where these sites of increased uptakes are located. So when we could add the CT and have the SPECT CT, we saw that in this particular case, and this I would call beginner's luck, we were able to identify a metastasis that was previously not known. And only because of this study, the patient went and received previously unplanned radioiodine treatment and had a good follow-up. So let's start with SPECT CT in oncology. And the first one is, as I already started, is thyroid cancer. I don't need to tell you a lot about the clinical facts in this cancer. Let me show you a few examples. This is, one second, I have to.
I think that this one would be better.
Oh, okay, perfect, yes. This is the study as we all used. I don't think that we can see the arrow on the computer. I can see it here. But in any way, on the left side, we see a total body planar iodine 131 scan. Excellent. This was more or less, we could guess if there is disease and where it is located. But when you look at the SPECT CT studies done at the various levels where we have the sites of uptake, we see that there can be that this patient had lung metastasis, he had a bone metastasis in the skull. We also see some remnant thyroid issue, as it is usually happens after surgery, and also some cervical lymph node metastasis. This is another patient where we had a surprise. We knew he had lung metastasis, but only by SPECT CT could we detect an additional, here you see it with the red arrow, liver metastasis. This is another patient that, if I would let you guess, I'm not so sure that you could tell me where this uptake is located. When you look at SPECT CT, it is a single bone metastasis in the sternum. And based on this study, the patient was referred to surgery. And this is another patient with a single lesion, again located in the skull, and this patient was as well located, referred to surgery. So, is this really important for patient management? This study shows that in patients with thyroid cancer and bone metastasis, the survival was much higher, significantly higher, in patients where the metastasis could be surgically removed. What we have learned using SPECT CT with iodine 131 is that not everything that we see, that is contrary to our initial belief, not everything that we see is thyroid cancer or thyroid tissue. We know now that iodine 131 can be taken up by many sites of physiologic uptake, by sites of benign processes, and it also show metastasis in sites that we did not know or were at least unusual to be metastasis of thyroid cancer. And these are just a few examples. This is a patient who had uptake, physiologic uptake in the stomach, but the stomach was located very high. He had a hiatal hernia. The second patient is a young patient who had received iodine treatment, and we see that there is uptake, physiologic uptake in thymic hyperplasia. The third patient on the right had sites of uptake in inflammatory processes following a dental procedure in the maxilla and following the insertion of an intrauterine device in the uterus. It is also important that when you can do SPECT CT and have a diagnostic or a CT of better quality, you can see sites of uptake, that sites of disease on the CT component that do not take up iodine 131. In some cases, when you compare it with findings of FDG PET CT and see the mismatch, the uptake on FDG and the lack of uptake of iodine, this is definitely a poor prognosis. And this is just a summary on the value, on the role of iodine SPECT CT in differentiated thyroid cancer. And you will be able to see this in a paper, I'll come back to that, that will soon be published. Going further to SPECT CT in endocrinology, we know that there can be assessment of neuroendocrine neoplasms in using octreotide labeled with either iodine indium 111 or technetium 99m. This is a normal study here, this is the scintigraphic approach of choice in pancreatic islet cell tumors, in medullary thyroid cancer, carcinoid and paraganglioma. These are again two of our early patients. Both were suspected to have a recurrent neuroendocrine tumors, and on planar imaging, both show almost the same pattern. But when we go to SPECT CT, in the first patient, there was a metastatic lymph node. In the second patient, there was intrathecal uptake. It was a metastatic site in the spine. And the treatment, according to our oncologist and the endo-oncologist colleagues, was different. This is another patient where we saw this area of uptake. This was a patient with no known neuroendocrine tumor. She had high gastrin levels. CT was negative. Endoscopic ultrasound was negative. SPECT CT diagnosed, detected the primary tumor and localized it to a primary gastrinoma in the head of the pancreas, further removed at surgery. Lately, there are sites who can do octreotide scintigraphy using technetium labeling, which in my opinion is much better. And these are some slides provided to me by my friend, Professor Bouyousef from Algiers. And you can see here a metastatic pheochromocytoma with sites of metastasis in cervical lymph nodes, the mediastinum and the renal hilum. And also another patient with a neuroendocrine tumor of the pancreatic head with multiple liver metastasis confirmed by pathology. To summarize this, and this is again a paper that I would very much recommend, we see that SPECT CT can help in localizing and characterizing the majority of foci of neuroendocrine tumors with very high sensitivity and specificity. Another agent where we have used SPECT/CT successfully is iodine 123 MIBG in tumors originating a neural crest, in pheochromocytomas in adult patients and neuroblastoma in children. This is one of our patients in a young lady, a girl actually, who had to have sinus surgery, but during anesthesia she had spikes of hypertension. So surgery was interrupted and she started an assessment because of suspected pheochromocytoma. On CT, she had two abdominal masses, but on MIBG, only one of them took up the radio tracers and was considered to be the functional tumor. But when we looked at the study, at the whole body study, we saw an additional area of uptake in the femur. And based on these findings, guiding by these findings, biopsy was done and it was a metastasis of the pheochromocytoma. And just to make a parenthesis, I think that one of the important roles of SPECT/CT is in, or of hybrid imaging in general, is in guiding tissue sampling to the functional areas of suspicious site. In pediatric patients, neuroblastoma is maybe one of the most or the most common solid tumor. Again, iodine 123 MIBG is successfully used. When you have this kind of images, it is clear that this is neuroblastoma even from planar images. But in other cases, it is more difficult. Like in this patient who actually had a mediastinal neuroblastoma, or in this patient where SPECT/CT allowed to define the whole extent of the metastatic involvement, going to mediastinal lymph nodes, to the liver, to the bone, and to some additional lymph nodes above and below the diaphragm. A little bit about the lymphoscintigraphy and using our modalities for defining or determining the detecting and localizing the sentinel node. When you have this kind of images in planar images, it is difficult to be more precise. Historically, lymphoscintigraphy has started in patients with breast cancer and with melanoma. But lately, because we are now able to use SPECT/CT and to avoid the pitfalls and limitations that we saw on planar scintigraphy, this has evolved to some other areas. These are a few patients with melanoma, and we know that in melanoma, sentinel node mapping is particularly important because melanoma, the lymphatic drainage can be very variable, as here where we have a number of sentinel lymph nodes in the same basin, in the axilla, and here in this patient where we have drainage to multiple basins, specifically to both axilla. And this is another patient with a more simple case with a single uptake in the right, in one sentinel node in the right axilla. We have moved to many other malignancies, and very important today is lymphoscintigraphy with SPECT/CT in cancers of the head and neck, like in these patients, or in cancers, gynecological cancers, such as cancer of the vulva in this patient, or cervical cancer in other cases. Bone scintigraphy is our bread and butter in nuclear medicine. It is sensitive, but has a low specificity, with one in four patients with cancer presenting with equivocal findings. When we can do bone SPECT/CT, and specifically multi-field of view bone SPECT/CT, then we can make the diagnosis of metastasis at different levels with high specificity and be much more precise. And these are a few studies that have been done over the years, most of them in Germany, showing that SPECT CT has decreased significantly the number of equivocal sites on bone scintigraphy, and increased the mainly by defining most of these sites as benign processes unrelated to the cancer. And of course, and this is what I believe should be done from now on in general for those who have the possibility to do that in patients with cancer, is do whole body SPECT CT. And this is just one of our cases in a patient with breast cancer that was where the bone planar bone scan was reported as normal. And SPECT CT diagnosed a single bone metastasis in the skull that was further confirmed by other imaging modalities. Also, SPECT CT can identify cancer-related lesions that are not in the skeleton. We know that there can be classifications and uptake of technetium MDP in metastasis in the soft tissues. And this is one patient, one of our patients who had colon cancer. This was the finding that we saw. He came because he had pelvic pain. We were unable, it was from our point of view an equivocal finding when we looked at the planar images, but when we looked at SPECT CT, we could make the diagnosis of a calcified metastasis in the left psoas muscle. So there are some nice studies that have been done on bone SPECT CT in cancer patients coming from Israel, from my colleague Enate Ben-Sapir. And we see that in a very large number, in the very large majority of patients, SPECT CT either made the final diagnosis or suggested the further workup. Lately, some work has been done mainly in Germany in using SPECT CT prior or after transarterial radioembolization, either for a better mapping of the tumor feeding vessel, for a better assessment of the distribution and potential presence of a severe lung shunting, or as an adjunct to calculate the therapeutic dose, and after treatment to verify that the sphere distribution was indeed as initially suggested. And this is a study provided to me by Professor Lafougère from Tübingen, and we can see that their important conclusion in this recent paper in the Journal of Nuclear Medicine was that by quantitative SPECT CT, the lung shunting, the lung shunt fraction was much smaller than initially estimated by planar images, and allowed them to include more patients than initially planned for this therapeutic procedure. Lung SPECT CT, it is being used by many, including us, for diagnosis of pulmonary embolism. Specifically, I would like to emphasize the use of lung SPECT CT in better assessment of patients with other types of lung disease, and specifically with lung cancer. This is one of our patients who had lung cancer, who had been treated with neoadjuvant chemotherapy. You can see the PET CT study before and after treatment, neoadjuvant treatment, and he was now planned to go to surgery. This is the planar perfusion study, lung perfusion study that was done, and this is the SPECT CT. And these are the findings. More important so, using the quantitative softwares that we have now available, this lung SPECT CT could be used to quantify the normal healthy lung reserve. And I know that this is being used now by many, both for pre-surgical assessment in patients with lung cancer, as well as prior to radiation treatment. Beyond oncology, SPECT CT is being intensely used for assessment of or for localization of parathyroid adenoma. We know that the surgical approach has changed lately, and minimally invasive surgery is being performed. And for that, the surgeons need a much better localization. In this case, we see the localization, and we could provide the surgeons with the clear clear topographic indications. And this is much more important when you have patients who have ectopic adenomas. And this is the way that our chest surgeon actually planned his surgical approach. And this is another patient with an ectopic parathyroid adenoma that by SPECT CT was localized to the thymus. We know that nuclear medicine or SPECT CT has historically started by attenuation correction in cardiology. I'm not going to show you many cases, just two of them. A patient where with attenuation correction we could actually exclude the presence of ischemia. It was the diaphragm attenuation artifact. And in another patient where we could make the diagnosis of ischemia in the lateral wall much easier using attenuation-corrected images. And we see that indeed attenuation correction has changed or has improved the specificity of myocardial perfusion imaging. And it is today recommended in most guidelines by most cardiac societies. This is a project that I have been very active over the last 2 years. It is a large group of colleagues coming mostly from Europe, but not only. We have reviewed over 600 publications, but we have included almost 500 publications that use SPECT CT for various indications. And we have seen that over the years, two decades after SPECT CT has been developed, we have new indications using new tracers in oncology, in non-oncology, as well as in cardiology. I have to show you how hybrid imaging started 60 years ago. This is a rectilinear scanner where the site of uptake was measured using a meter, and the patient was measured, and the site of disease was defined like that. We are definitely witnessing an era of revived interest in SPECT and SPECT CT, mainly because of a continuing evolution of technology and because we have gained expertise in the field. We still have to define where and how we should do SPECT CT. I believe that we have a very bright future in using SPECT CT in oncology and beyond. Thank you very much.